Akai jungle. Who is going to be the better tank jungle right here?
This is tough. This is tough, right? Again, this is going to come... It always comes down to execution, but I really do like how Smart Omega drafted here. TODAK obviously has a great one as well.
Well, 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 ladies and gentlemen, game one is on its way with TODAK on the blue side and Smart Omega on the red side. We are going to be seeing a Julian meet matchup against this Xavier and Moon currently. Not going to be having an easy time because the moment this Julian hits those level 3, we are going to be expecting a lot of wombo combos and aggressiveness coming from Smart Omega.
Yeah, we'll see what happens here. I mean, there's already so much...
There's already so much action. But, you know, early on, if you want to talk about it, I mean, you guys, or you mentioned it, right? The tank jungler starting this off. I feel like they're going to be setting the pace here. As you can see, Chaknu, okay, he didn't go with the emblem that I was thinking about because we've seen a version of this Chaknu Grok take an assassin emblem, the high and dry, and just turn into like basically an assassin tank that you wouldn't expect, right? With that paired up long stun. So that's not going to happen here, but doesn't mean he can't find those Chak Mamba plays.
Oh, this is a very cheeky play coming from Smart Omega. They're setting up Ryzen to actually go in for the in-base. Yumes is actually getting bullied out, but Moon, however, is going to get caught out. And unfortunately, just like that, Smart Omega, they managed to punish TODAK with this split decision.
Yeah, first blood is going to the hands of TODAK here, as Omega will be... Okay, they're looking for something, right? Because honestly, when it comes down to that expectation, but oh my god, but wait a minute, the Destonata connects onto Ryzen here, and Ryzen will be the one to go down next. So already two trades on the board, one for one for the side of TODAK as well as Omega. As for Maze here, he was caught in a 2v1 situation, but luckily, being the Uranus, the sustainable hero that he is, he still will be able to get away.
Oh, it's not over yet. Seems like Kelra is going to be able to get out of there, forcing a major sprint right in that vicinity. But so far, TODAK, they made it a little bit of blunder. Fortunately for them, they were able to salvage the situation for Moon, especially when he needs those economy boosts to actually come online. Whereas E2 Max now is going to try and bait out the jungle pit. As of yet, I don't exactly sure how they're going to be happening here because Momo is coming into Contested Turtle.
Yeah, the contest comes here. The chains does not connect, but it does seem like Ryzen might be caught here. But wait a minute. Chaknu actually misses that, but unfortunately, it is going to be Momo there in that front line dealing and actually absorbing a lot of damage. Formaze goes in for a 1v4 situation. He gets low, but the dog light connects onto three members. E2 Max goes down next, and that is going to be one trade for the side of TODAK.
Nice dawning light placement there. I mean, I feel like Smart Omega just lined up for that one. And it was a sticky situation to be in, but you know, at the same time, they were able to secure that objective. Hopefully they can convert that into something, but right now, TODAK doing pretty good at dissecting Smart Omega.
This is exactly what I've been talking about throughout the drafts as well. They need some sort of heroes that can chunk through all this beefy composition. TODAK is just so, so very tanky, and it's just so difficult to kill them. However, at the same time right now, Windtalker up on Kelra. He needs a couple more items before he starts to pop off, and Yubes is just buying so much space from the side of TODAK. And because of this, it is going to allow Chiku to accelerate his farm as compared to Kelra.
Right now, though, with, you know, Kelra being on this Irithyll pick, so far, I feel like what we've seen up to this point is it works and sometimes it doesn't. It really does matter on how you're able to avoid all the CC that's going to be coming from TODAK. And that's, I feel like, what Irithyll does best, especially paired with a sprint. That's like unlimited mobility.
Yep, and at the same time as well, I'm a little bit surprised by Smart Omega's composition to set up Kelra to go for an early engagement. He only just got a Windtalker, so I don't think he's going to give a little too much value. And because of this, Chiku was able to get a free gold plating down bottom. So this is a huge win for TODAK's marksman as of yet. But now, up on screen, this is going to be the emblems for the players themselves that they have chose for their heroes.
Emblems, I mean... Not surprised by a lot of these, honestly. It's somewhat standard, right? And at the same time, I feel like a lot of this is going to have to do with those mid laners. Like we talked about in the draft, you know, putting Moon against E2 Max. I feel like this is the one great thing about a Xavier is a lot of the times you can just go ahead and get your distance, get your CC off, throw the Dawning Light out, especially about every 15 seconds or so later on in the game. Whereas E2 Max has to work a little bit harder on this Julian.
Okay, but now they both teams are going to be putting their focus onto the next turtle here. It does seem like Omega has the dub in that situation, but it actually will be taken out with them as well. Oh no, it seems like Momo is caught in a bad situation. 4v1, he gets caught out, and that is going to be it. That is Momo taken down, traded back for their team.
Oh, a big, big win coming from Omega, especially coming from heavy speed to cancel out the thing, but the fight is not over yet. As you can see, TODAK, this is the Langa strategy that we talked about as well. As soon as you disengage and you thought the fight was over, TODAK re-engages and trades off perfectly. And that's a big catch as well, because Hera being taken down means Chiku is in a prime position contested. However, at the fight as of now, you can see they are focusing on inhibitors. Raisin is gonna be coming in, he flickers out, and here comes Raisin, and they catch the kill on towards him, and that is gonna be TODAK greeting a little bit too much and get punished for it.
Yeah, way too aggressive from the side of TODAK there. I understand they were able to get a kill onto Kelra. That would have been enough, but you know, putting Chiku in that situation, he having to be traded back, that kind of gives TODAK a little bit of a bad trade in that sense. So we'll see what happens here, as it is going to be a little bit more stale in that sense, because they are waiting for that neutral objective to pop off.
I honestly feel like this, yeah, like you said, right? This is two junglers, two tank junglers that are just, they're looking for their own individual moments to set up here. And a lot of it will just come down to those objective fights later on, because so far what we're seeing, pretty much what I said in the draft, it's going to be scrappy. Both teams seem like they are making some minor mistakes. I would say even earlier, you know, Kelra popped this sprint there and got caught by the holy baptism.
Yeah, I definitely agree. And on top of all, based on the items as well, you can see a little bit of regeneration coming from 4 Maze. I was expecting an early Enchanted Talisman coming from him on this Uranus, but considering based on the emblems itself, he opted to go for a hybrid damage build on the Avarice emblem instead of the usual hybrid regeneration. So I like the little bit of adaptation for him to compensate damage to make it a little bit more tankier. And it's working out just because of how Omega is lacking in terms of burst potential until Kelra probably gets like 2, 3, 4 items to come. But as of yet, the turtle is on his way, and looks like there is going to be some sort of contest.
Chakra was in a little bit of a weird situation there, but luckily there was backup coming in from Omega. Now they are going to be trying to fill each other out, trying to open some vision as an engage might happen here. The turtle is going to be so low. It will be taken by the side of Omega, but we'll see what happens here as Momo is in a 4v1 situation. The Dawning Light connects onto three members,
big,
but the damage coming
big
through is just so much. Kelra gets taken down first. This is going to be interesting as Renzio was also taken down. A 2-for-1 trade for the moment, as for Maze, he is looking for Ryzen. Luckily, he still manages to get out.
This is huge coming from TODAK. They understand that the finisher is none other than 4 Maze, but Changnu, he's going to buy a little bit more time for the team, and hopefully they are going to be able to stall it out, because as of now, TODAK, they're feeling a little bit too confident with themselves that they might actually pay the price, because they're taking a little bit too long to take this middle turret, but from behind.
Oh my god, Ryzen goes in from the back, but unfortunately there was no follow-up. He doesn't connect per se on that spin, so luckily enough for the side of TODAK, they were able to kind of sniff that play out and come out of there alive.
So you see that they were trying to find the setup there. I mean, even Chaknu himself looking a little frustrated there, because he was trying to buy time for that setup, and unfortunately TODAK sniffed that out, wasn't gonna happen, and they're happy with it. As you can see from the damage dealt too, right, you have Renzio leading that, but actually this is a surprise to see Ethumax here leading that in the second place, because honestly I feel like so much of this damage is relying on Kelra, because Ethumax tries to get those combos off the best he can, but again, the toolkit on TODAK is stopping any kind of initiation. Like, they have a lot of counter initiation alone with just that holy baptism.
Yeah, I definitely agree. And on top of all, E2Max's burst potential is going to be focusing on the supports. In this case, Yumes and Chiku is going to be his objective. However, we've got Moon constantly making sure that they do not get caught off. This two beefy, tanky compositions from TODAK is just a big wall that Omega needs to overcome. And the beauty about it is that the only one that can separate them is pretty much Ryzen on this heavy speed. So TODAK, they have to play this very, very safe. But the downside is they are losing a lot of split push potential because of this composition.
This has been one of the most like equal and like on that point stalemate between two teams that we've seen so far. I mean, TODAK and Omega, they're just trading that economy back and forth, as it is going to be the next neutral objective on the board there in that first Lord. So it doesn't seem like both teams want to go for it just yet. This is definitely the calm before the storm.
Yeah, this is too dicey of a situation for either team, because like you said,
Chiku!
My goodness!
What?
There is the burst damage right there that we usually see from that high priority hero pick in Chico on the Beatrix.
That is a huge, huge kill here for the side of TODAK. I mean, now they have the man advantage and they might want to go for it, but it actually does seem Chico Daknu is going in for the kill. E2 Max goes down first. We can see that the spin tries to go and get something, but unfortunately, nothing comes out of it.
Oh, that was a big smart play coming from Smart Omega. TODAK, they weren't expecting the flicker play coming from Chengdu, and that was huge. But at the same time, I feel like Smart Omega, they were a little bit gamed a little bit more in terms of mental aspect. They weren't expecting such an aggressive E-Tricks from the get-go, considering how passive Chico has been playing throughout this game. With this aggressive play, now Smart Omega, they have to rethink their formations. And as of yet, the Lord is going to be started out. As you can see, both the tanks coming in from Omega as well as TODAK, Four Maze and Razor, just trying to bait reactions from each other.
Man, right now, Kelrod needs to hurry up on that Orange Rush because they're going to go ahead and bounce this Lord around each other. No one wants to commit to it just yet. And like you guys mentioned, gold lane matchup here, Chico, right? He's feeling confident. That's what we saw, that Bush play right there. He had the flicker. But so is, at that point, Kelrod. He didn't have a kill just yet, but despite that kind of struggle he had in the early game because they were focusing so much on his lane, he's starting to actually get confidence now too because he's starting to see that damage potential on this Irithyll pick.
I definitely agree, but as of now, Chico once again setting up a very similar play and Smart Omega, they roughly know what's going on. Momo face checking on the bottom side as well. They know that Smart Omega is going to be coming from the bottom side, but the Lord is going to be resetted. But Chengdu is keeping his mount on Chico, forcing a flicker means they are going to back off. So TODAK cannot make that play. So very, very smart reactions and adaptations coming from Smart Omega as of yet. But looks like this time they are going to try and bait out the reactions from TODAK, considering that Chico does not have his flicker to gate out. As you can see, Chico playing on the safer role rather than the offensive style that he's been playing for the past 5 minutes.
For the moment, it does seem like both teams, they're just trying to dance around this turtle. I mean, they started, they reset it, but we'll see what happens as Four Maze is very far out there out. So it does seem like Omega for the moment has that man advantage, but once again, they are going to choose to disengage.
I mean, the big thing here is, again, this is the eternal battle. You saw how far they're cutting right down in the bottom lane. Both of them at the same time. They don't have enough space. That's why we're not seeing anything break out here because both tier one turrets are still up in the mid lane. So someone's got to make a move, and that's what they're looking
for.
Oh, Chico.
Oh, no. Oh, no. Chico, he gets the shot. He takes him out. Oh, my goodness. Who would you expect that to happen? But he's all by himself. Yumes is going to be in there in the vicinity to help him now. Chico, he's going to make a run for him. But Momo is there to stop his range. He goes for the Tona. Welcome to try and catch Kelra. But no, Kelra zips out of his range. Chico gets caught out, and he's going to back out. But at the same time, Momo is trying his best to finish him off. And Tona, they want to get the kill. But Kelra is just so nimble. He takes down Moon. Momo almost gets taken down. But eventually he's a little bit too low. Renzio gonna be tagging the turtle as of yet. But TODAK, they're crumbling to pieces, and Renzio will get the trade-off just like that. 3-for-2 exchange from Omega as well as TODAK.
The way that they were able to set up for that team fight was beautiful. They tried to split it up and it eventually was in the favor of Omega, but once again, it does seem Renzio might be caught in a weird situation here. He is taking a lot of damage, even though he is on that Esmeralda. Four Maze. Can he do this? I mean, 3v4 situation, they are still going on this Lord.
He can't fight, he can't compete here with the Retribution, so they should be able to secure that. There's the Dawning Light, it is secured. Oh, Ryzen, you gotta get out of there, you're in trouble. There's the knockup though, Forme is actually gonna chase for a little bit, but should be able to get away. Ryzen's just fine right now, they secure the Lord. Check out the gold lead too, it's starting. Oh, he gets through the Guardian's barrier here, so he's gonna be fine. They finally get that mid turret down as well.
Oh, that was a huge, huge play coming from Omega as well. They managed to punish Chico's over-aggression, and because of that, that was her downfall. But before that, let's take a look at the instant replay on how it all went down. As you can see up on screen, initially you can see that Chico was like being out of position, and because of this, it forced Kelra to actually disengage from Momo. But by that time, you can see that he's already level 13. He's starting to have like 4 item powers by in. You can see that TODAK's composition is starting to fall apart by this run-and-gun strategy.
Ryzen was really punishing Yums there. Yums had the ability to try and help his fellow comrades, but unfortunately he was just split off so bad, pressured away so bad, that never happened. The Lord does go down rather easily though here in this particular stage, so Omega was not able to kind of take the whole thing that they could have with that Lord push.
This is the thing, oh man, he gets him against the wall, you can't escape this one. That's going to be another kill going to Omega. They further their gold lead, taking control of this side of the jungle as well, of TODAK. Another turret going to be taken by them. So they're finding these objectives around the map. It works well for them. right now, TODAK actually having their backs against the wall.
Yeah, I definitely agree. Yeah, it's just so much of a lead as of yet. And this lead is actually helping Omega because Kelra is level 15 and he can run all he wants. Look at this, he's starting to chip away and TODAK wherever. They want to force Omega in a very, very tight spot to benefit from the Dawning Light. And it's just not helping out in that regard. And Omega, they finally realize that the way to win against TODAK right now is to isolate those fights. And Ryzen's heavy spin is going to be a core winning factor as of yet. But let's take a look at the items, especially coming from Kelra. He's already almost heading towards his final item. Potentially the Melvic Roar to actually chunk towards the structures.
I'm a little relieved, right? We take a look at the Beatrix. There's no double BOD, so a little different
doesn't
to what
need
we
it.
Saw.
I mean, like, okay, both of them also now, both gold laners. I keep going back to this gold lane matchup because it is very important here for the game. They both have Wind of Natures now, right? So if they can buy more time, but the advantage, once again, that Irithyll really has, especially with the sprint, the mobility, right?
Yeah.
The mobility is a huge factor here. So if he can continue to bob and weave through those team fights, the objective things, again, Kelra is going to have that advantage. So the placement, the positioning for Chico has to be very, very on point.
Yeah, I definitely agree. Like, initially when Chico was setting up those kind of plays, it actually worked out. But that because of that misplay as well, because with him being caught out, it allowed Kelra to actually make a small comeback and accelerate his farm. And ever since that happened, Kelra is in a prime position to go for that run and gun strategy, which counter negates on what TODAK actually wants in this draft, which is a full head-on fight right from the ghetto in a tight spot, which is something that Omega can benefit from it, but not as much as what TODAK can do in this side team fights.
I don't know. I think, wouldn't that benefit Omega a bit more? I mean, with the heavy spin to be able to connect onto their integral members, I think that's something that can be achieved.
It's so far, honestly, so far from what we've seen, I'm still going back to the term I use in the draft. It's scrappy. It's messy. Nothing is clean in this game so far. Even that earlier team fight before that Lord was taken, it was just a mess, honestly. And so at some point, whichever team gets it together faster here, will come out on top for this game, number one.
Yeah, I definitely agree. It all comes down to a stage where, as of now, the fallback plan coming from TODAK is going to be relying on Moon on that Xavier to actually potentially scare him off, and it's going to be very difficult to do so. And to get to that stage, they have to buy a lot of time on Moon, which is currently level 12. As you can see, Four Maze is constantly split pushing his pressure as well. You can also see Renzi on Omega mirroring it up to make sure that the bottom lane does not get shoved up too hard. So as of now, it's all about finding and jumping those opportunities coming from the fight. But as of yet, Kelra, he's level 15. He's ready to party all the way through. The triple sprint is going to benefit them a lot, whereas TODAK, it's going to be hard to disengage.
You know, going back again to the keys of victory, the early to mid-game transition, that is what TODAK needed. But, you know, even though they had a little bit of control here and there, it was never as smooth as they wanted it to. And now, with the next big objective up, this Lord, it's going to be that push and pull again because things feel like they're pretty easy. Oh, Jack, you're going to take quite a bit of damage.
Yeah, Dawning Light comes through here. Actually, he's going to chunk, but look at how aggressive Yumes is playing, using that flicker to be able to give a little bit more presence on the board. Two members from the side of Omega for the moment are going to be very low. It does force a retreat coming through, and therefore a big man advantage.
Oh, look at the wraparound from Chaknu as well. He's looking for the fight against Chico, but at the same time, the Lord is down to his second bar. Chaknu, however, is roaming very, very far back to cut the exit. Dawning Light comes in, and so again, you can see Omega, they're going to force the issue. Chico's going to be there. He's bursting a lot of damage. Renzio underestimating it all, but at the same time, Momo loses out the retreat fight. The Lord is going to be in the hands of Omega. As you can see, they are going to be forcing the issue. A big wall. Chak catches on three of TODAK members. They need to make a run for it. They will lose Moon in the process, and now Chaknu is going to fall. Chico is still alive. He takes down the Julian. He gets the double kill, but he's so, so very low. And they are going to focus him up and runs in towards the face of Kelra, and he will pay the price. He thought he can one-shot him, but Kelra is just a little bit too much. And now Yung is going to be the next to fall. Momo comes in, can't exactly do too much.
A 4-for-2 trade was just so huge. I got to say, Chico is overestimating himself in a lot of moments. I do understand he wanted to go in for that last kill, but unfortunately, he got taken down in the process, and this isn't good, right? Because there is only one member left from the side of TODAK to be able and try to defend this one. Moon is going to be up real soon, but look at the Lord, just so dominant there in that bottom side as the Dawning Light is going to be used here to try and clear those lanes.
Again, I feel like this is just showing the kind of weak points in what TODAK drafted here, because you're relying so much on that heavy damage coming out from Chico. Yes, you have Moon on the Xavier pick, but so far from what we've seen through the statistics, you have Dawning Light, right? You have the CC, but at the same time, it's not enough to go against what everything else is being thrown at you here from Smart Omega.
Jackal here, I think he's looking for a moment, but the Dawning Light is going to chunk Kelra to half health. We'll see what Ryzen can do, perhaps to maybe look for an engage as well, because that's the beautiful thing about Omega's lineup, right? They have two sources of people that can potentially look for a huge engage onto those really prime members like Chiku as well as Moon.
I definitely agree, but with the inhibitor down on the bottom, TODAK, they are going to be oppressed all the way at the bigs. They need to find a very, very big catch-up. Kelra now is going to be a prime target. The Dawning Light misses on him, so it's not going to be enough to scare off Omega as they continue with the suppression on TODAK's base. And looks like they want a little bit more. Are they going to try and force the issue? You can see Ryzen looking for an opportunity to try and go for the jump onto his Moon, but he seems to be very, very patient about it. Seems like it's not going to happen anytime soon, and they have to sound the retreat. 50 seconds left before the next Lord. But on this bottom side as well, Chagnu.
Yeah, Chagnu is actually going to look for a play. Chiku has to force that flicker outside, but the Falling Star Moon actually connects onto Chiku. Chiku goes down first. It does seem like Moon might be the next target, but unfortunately, he is able to survive this one.
Man, and right now, this is full control, but actually Momo's still going to keep them at bay here. Meanwhile, in the bottom lane, Dawning Light's going to come out. Kelra takes quite a bit of damage. Daytona's Welcome's going to be popped too. He's going to throw him into the base. They should be able to pick up a kill here. They find Renzio. Now they're turning this one around. As Max has to get out here. Ryzen, you don't want to be there as well, as he's continuously getting slowed by the team of TODAK. Kelra and Chagnu might be looking for a play. The conceal comes out. Triple kill for the Dawning Light from Moon. Kelra, get out of there, because Chagnu's running for his life as well. That's going to be one more.
Give him the maniac.
It's only a matter of time. There you go. They don't give him the maniac, though.
Unofficial maniac, though. That was a huge play coming in from TODAK. The way that they saw the engage from Omega, but instantly use it to capitalize back.
Oh, this is huge. Instead of going for the Lord, they're 30 seconds on the sidelines as well, and they're pushing the base. The only one that can stop them is Kelra. They've got the damage, but Moon catches them up. They take him out, and TODAK, they make the comeback. They're trying to close out game number one, and just like that, TODAK, they are doing it. They're knocking onto the bases. Renzio is there. They're popping the Falling Star Moon to defend against this. They don't have the minions. Renzio is going to clear it off, but eventually it's 4v2. E2 Max is going to be there. Momo just going to finish him off, and that's going to be another kill in the hands of TODAK. They're knocking on towards Omega, but Ryzen is here. He does have the heavy spin. The minions are coming in, but he can't stall for time, and this is not looking good for TODAK. They have to get out, but no, they want to force it, and now Omega, they're doing it. E2 Max taking a lot of damage. Can they kill him off? No, he cannot, and TODAK have to sound the horn of retreat and back off, but Omega, they're not letting him off the hook. They want to go for more, four mains once the challenge is, but seems like it is going to be a stalemate. TODAK, are they going to try the challenge a lot? Looks like they are going to try it, but is it worth it? Kelra is down alive in 2 seconds. They are going to be coming back for this next fight. This is going to be extremely risky.
Spectacular play coming in from Renzio, being able to buy so much time for their team and actually giving them another fighting chance. It does seem like TODAK might have the upper hand here, but look at this. Chagnu looks for an engage. The Dawning Light connects, but unfortunately will not get that Lord. It actually will fall into the hands of Yums.
How did Yums get that? I mean, the retribution was even given, and now Ryzen gets taken down. Immortality is going to be popped. They're going to find this kill here. Now TODAK in full control so far, but their base is still exposed.
Oh, this is huge from TODAK. They got the timing they wanted, and that is was Moon. And ever since he got his 15, that is where he shined the most. And Kelra could not withstand the initial burst coming in, and that is just what turns things around. But now, with this Lord coming in from TODAK, is it going to be enough? I don't think so, because Omega, they still have so much damage potential, and Kelra just got his immortality.
I mean, if we take a look at the damage dealt, it does seem like Moon and Chiku have the highest damage. Kelra is not far behind, but that makes sense, right? So much damage, so much pressure comes out from that chunk in that Dawning Light, and it just it inhibits the movements coming in from Omega. I mean, look at that. And he can basically just spam that ability.
Yep, it seems like TODAK is going to be coming in as well. Well, they're getting blocked off by Kelra, taking a little bit too much damage. He might fall. Is this a good choice? Kelra, they're going to focus on him. That's going to be the first immortality. While the rest of TODAK, they don't really care. They're focusing the crystal, and they take game one against Smart Omega. What a game coming from TODAK. The Swordfish.
Against
strikes.
The defending champions, the King of the Seas. It is still game number one. They still have a chance to come back, but my, oh my, have they exceeded.